today's scripture is from John chapter 20. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Morning, church. Good to see you, and great to be here on this Easter. Let me pray. Lord Jesus, I want to thank you, God, for your goodness and your grace. We just love you, Lord. We give you praise today. Let your word just shine into our hearts and those that need to hear it. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd be remiss to not start the Easter service with a top five list. I did a top 10 list for Christmas a couple years ago. I want to know, I love top five lists. I don't know about you, but I'm a top five guy. The irony of it is that my wife hates top five lists. And let me tell you why there's irony. Because I chose to date her based on a top five list. Ladies, hang out. Wasn't that kind of list, all right? It wasn't like, you know, this misogynistic list. No, it was. You think that's funny, Zach? Okay. No, let me tell you what was on my list. This is dead serious. I'm driving and I'm just thinking, you know, there's a couple girls I was interested in. I was with my friend. I was looking to get married. I wasn't looking to date. I was, you know. And so on the list was this. You could play Scrabble with this woman. And I was like, yeah, totally. Could see myself. You could take a long road trip with this woman and have great conversation. Yes. Number three, great snowboarder. Got to be a great snowboarder. So number three. So the list wasn't what you think a normal list would be. It actually was my list. And I ended up asking her out. 25 years later, it looks like it worked out. So, but she won't do a top 10, 5 list. She won't do any list. And this is how it usually goes. Driving to Mammoth to go snowboarding or skiing together. And I always loved her because she would just get in her car at like 4 in the morning on her own and like drive up on her own when she was like 24 years old to go ski Mammoth and stay at that janky Motel 6 up there. And we'll be driving up and I'll be like, okay, top 5 tacos in San Diego. And she's just like, I don't like top 5 lists. I'm like, top 5. She goes, can I think about it? I'm like, well, we got about 6 hours, yeah. She's all, I kind of need till tomorrow. And I'm like, okay. I came up with a top 5 list of my favorite actors for you today. I'm going to give you my favorite actors. And I'm not saying that these are the best actors ever. Because whenever you do a top 10 list or 5 list, isn't there always you kind of want to impress people with your decisions, right? You kind of want to, so I thought of everybody I could impress you with. But instead, I just came up with my favorite actors. So favorite is not best. There's better actors. Favorite. Daniel Day-Lewis, right? Daniel Day-Lewis. Now, millennials, you can look it up on Google. Daniel Day-Lewis. Just kidding. Sorry, why do you get so much shade to the millennials? Denzel. I love myself. You like some Denzel? Dude, I loved him, and he got Game, the basketball movie, when he played Jesus Shuttleworth's father as an ex-convict. Now, this one, almost embarrassed about it. But in the end, he's in a ton of my favorite movies. Leonardo DiCaprio, got to say it. He's in there. Leonardo, and can I have that outfit? That is so cool, cardigan sweater. I used to be embarrassed about this one. Now I think it's my coolest one. Keanu Reeves. I love myself some Keanu Reeves. So that's him from John Wick. And then my favorite, my favorite, not the best actor, but he's a pretty good actor. Favorite actor of all time. Wait for it. What, really? No, wait for it, Diva. Second thought. Media team, don't wait for it. No, it's Clint Eastwood. She's up there. Hi, Neva. Just giving you a hard time. Clint Eastwood. When I was a teenager, my mom put me on a week's restriction. And during that week, we had Cinemax. And I don't know if you know what Cinemax is, but you go to school. And I was watching all these movies on Cinemax. And the movies that they had was a film festival of Clint Eastwood's spaghetti westerns. Now, the spaghetti western were these movies where Clint comes in. He's like a drifter. In all these movies, they were made in Italy. He was a drifter, and he would come in, and somebody would have done some injustice. And Clint Eastwood comes in and rights the wrong. Now, what is interesting in all these movies, Clint's actually a homeless man. I don't know if you know that. Like, he never has a house. And then he comes in and writes The Injustice, which is totally cool. I totally like that. But he would come in. Let me just give you a couple of these movies that were in there, and then we're going to get right to this scripture, and there's a reason. Fistful of Dollars. You ever see Fistful of Dollars? And these pictures are awesome. Hang 'em High. Remember that movie? Hang 'em High was a great movie. I would break my face if I tried to look like that. That is so cool. Outlaw Josie Wales. Awesome movie. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. Here's what's the true about all these movies. In all of these movies, an injustice had been done, and they needed some rough justice to right the wrong. They needed what they call High Plains rough justice to right the wrong. They would come in, and he would bring his peacemakers. And these peacemakers would use violence to restore the peace and come and bring peace to a place that had had an injustice. When we look at this passage, we see Jesus, also a homeless man. Don't know if you understood that. Jesus was actually homeless during the 3 years of his ministry. He was a High Plains drifter like Clint. And he comes in this passage to a group of Jews that have been following him, that were expecting him to take over the Romans, that were expecting something more than what he gave them, but less than what he was offering. And he comes in amidst them, amidst their fear, locked into a room, and he says one thing to them. He says, peace. Jesus is a peace bringer. Now, the sermon title was called Peacemaker, but Jesus is actually a peace bringer. And what I mean by that is he made peace. You see, Jesus had rough justice to bring, but he didn't bring it to the outlaws. The rough justice that Jesus brought, if you were to study the Bible, you would understand that the justice that he brought to pay for the sin, because the wrath of God was upon sin, was actually to himself, which is so interesting. If you remember the movie High Plains Drifter, there was a group of outlaws that were coming to the town, and they were going to burn the town down. And Clint Eastwood shows up, and he tells the people in the town, he says, I got an idea. He says, paint the town red. And he painted the town red, and then he wrote hell on the town. So when they rode into it, they were riding into hell, you know. Or maybe you saw Tombstone where he said, you tell him I'm coming. What did he say in Tombstone? Was it Kurt Russell? And hell's coming with me. And so he's there in this place. Jesus, like these archetype heroes, comes and he brings peace. Go to verse 19. On the evening of that final day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fears of the Jews. Circle that and stop. Locked for fear of the Jews. You know, we're in a society where so many of us today are locked behind the walls of our heart, are locked for so many different reasons behind this wall of fear. And Jesus comes in amidst the fear, and he stands in the midst of this fear, and he meets them in that place. So he comes behind there. We'll look at that in just a second. Now, what were they afraid of? They were afraid of the Jewish leaders. We're all afraid of something. I was listening to a podcast this week, and they said fear and anxiety is part of the human condition. And the Jews were the Jews that were in the room, because remember, the Jews that were the leaders helped kill Jesus, but the Jews that were his followers were afraid that they were going to be next, but they were both groups of Jewish people. Jesus came and stood among them, and then he said this incredible thing. He says, peace be with you. Circle, be with you. We'll get to that in a second. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Remember, he had been pierced here. He had been nail-marked hands and feet, and he showed him his side. And what he was offering to them, as we'll see in just a moment, is a peace treaty. He's offering them the actual physical example of what brought peace, of the rough justice that was done to bring peace, because there wasn't an enmity between a High Plains drifter and a bunch of outlaws. There was an enmity between God and mankind, and not God and man, because God is not angry at man. God is angry at sin. And there was a sermon by a guy named Jonathan Edwards. And Jonathan Edwards had a sermon. It was called, maybe you've heard it from the 1800s, Sinners in the Hand of an Angry God. Ooh, that's terrifying. I wouldn't go to church. Like, seriously, if you would have known, hey, come to Easter, I'm doing a sermon, Sinners in the Hand of an Angry God, you know, that wouldn't work, right? I think he should have changed it. It's Sinners in the hand of a loving God. But what God hates is sin. He hates it so much that he wants to dole out justice upon sin, and someone needs to pay the price. So what happened? He paid it himself. He paid it upon the cross, is the scripture. Now, if you go into the first thing we got to talk about is the elephant in the room. Go to verse 19 again. On that evening, on the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the door locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came in and stood among them. I don't know if you know about this actual miracle, but Jesus actually teleported into the room. How cool is that, right? Like, there's an elephant in the room, and is this. If you were going to follow Jesus and understand Jesus, it is faith, and it's understanding that God not only created, but he is over all of what he created. And so we see Jesus actually show up. I think it's one of his coolest miracles, except when he flew into space. So people kind of always talk about healing the blind man and all these things. My favorite miracles are like when he flies and teleports. I don't know about you guys just looking at me. If you're like, hey, I can't really do that whole like Jesus supernatural thing, just pretend like you're at a Marvel movie right now, okay? And you can focus on that. Because we're longing for something that is beyond what we can see. You see, there's a supernatural component. Now, why is that important? Because when it comes to peace and asking where peace comes from, and that's the next question on your notes, where does peace come from? If you were to read the Bible and you want to actually understand the Bible, if you want to read the Bible, you would see that peace is God. God is not peace. God is peace, but, excuse me, God is not all peace. God is more than peace. He is peace, he is love, he is joy. But peace is a component of him. And it's an eternal component. So the Bible would say that peace just exists because it exists in the deity and in the substance and being of God. It is a reality because it is God. So when Jesus offers peace, he's not offering peace from a bunch of slogans. He's offering peace from himself. And the reason it's real is because he is peace and he can actually offer it. If you're perhaps a secular materialist, and I have a lot of friends who are secular materialists, you would ask them where peace comes from, and they would tell you, well, it is from biology, it is from an evolutionary thought, and the reason you have peace is because there are some squirts that happened in your brain of some dopamine or some other, function of the brain, and something caused that to happen, but you're happy. So it also means this, that you love your children because of a few squirts of some, dopamine or, some type of chemical in the brain, that actually, that is where the love comes from. Now, what the Bible actually says is that it's more than that. It's actually got an essence of God himself, and God has given us the ability, through things like squirts in the brain of dopamine and things like that, to experience peace and love. Those are the things that bring love and peace, but they're actually rooted in an eternal reality. So when Jesus shows up in the room, Jesus is saying to them, I'm bringing you peace. And it isn't because of a bunch of slogans. I was in Encinitas this week. I was helping my mom, and I was looking for some office space up there because I like to, I go and visit my mom and do some Zoom meetings and things. And so there's a place where you can go rent some office space. And I thought, well, I can have some office space because I can't really do it at my mom's place. And, she's always got, Days of Our Lives. I know she doesn't watch Days of Our Lives. So I got something going on, some music or something. And my mom likes to talk. So I was like, Mom, I'm on a Zoom call. I really can't talk about that right now. But nonetheless, so I go to this place. And if you've been to Encinitas, all right, Encinitas is the capital of Zen in San Diego. Does anybody get their Zen on more than Encinitas? I mean, they are so chill up in Encinitas, Like, if this was in Encinitas, half of y'all wouldn't have shoes on, And you'd be wearing patchouli oil and all that. You should have to have a license to wear that stuff, by the way. They should. You should have to have a license to wear that because I can't handle it. But nonetheless, I walk in there. No offense to the climbers. I see you, Brian. I walk in there, and all of the cubicles are decorated with, symbols of peace. There's, Tibetan prayer flags, and that's cool. Tibetan prayer flags, they're on top of Everest. I get it. And then there's a bunch of slogans. And as I look around, there's all these everywhere I look, 80% of them were, putting some statement up that I think is meant to bring you peace. And I get that. The Bible talks about that. I have slogans, I think, and verses, and I think that positive talk and all these things are important. But it's not the founding, I would say, cornerstone of where I'm building my peace from. Here's a few that I saw. Peace is found in your breath. Now, my wife would totally disagree with my breath and that. I am so sick of her offering me a piece of gum. If I wanted gum, I would buy gum. Y'all real nice to me, but I tell her, nobody else tells me my breath stinks, but you always offer me gum. Now, you can let me know, maybe everybody else in the world is nice. Peace is found in your breath. Manifest your truth. That was another one. Manifest your truth. Like truth can be manifested by you. I think what the Bible would say is God is truth, and I can basically say what truth, I can speak truth, what is, but I can't just make my own truth. So it was interesting. Manifest your truth, which I actually kind of, you can kind of believe in something and make it happen. I like that. All these I like. Be unapologetically you. And I like that one as well. Here's the thing. The statements are great. And I'd have them around me. You know, they don't bother me. But what I found was it felt like a bunch of people, especially in their 20s and 30s, that are plastering slogans all around their life in order to remind themselves to be happy. One of the most tragic things about the pandemic, and most of you have heard this statistic, that 25% of teenage girls dealt with thoughts of suicide or suicidal ideation. 25% of teen girls. 25%. Don't do it now. Google it afterwards. That's a lot. Only 8% of boys. Really interesting. A lot of The Atlantic just had an article about how that is comparing themselves and Instagram and all these things. I want to say the world is not peaceful. Look at Ukraine. It's not just think about Ukraine. What about Syria? What about some of the streets of the city? What about the subway in New York? As I'm looking around, the world is not peaceful. And beyond it not being peaceful, there aren't very many people that are peaceful. There was a quote I saw in one of the cubicles. Many people think excitement is happiness. But when you're excited, you're not peaceful. True happiness is based on peace. So where does peace come from? What the Bible says, and you don't have to agree with it, but what the Bible says is God is peace and God offers peace to us. He offers it. He harvests it out of himself because it is an ultimate reality. And there is no peace on that. If you're going to have slogans, if you're going to have a trip, if you're going to do all these things that are supposed to bring you peace, it has to have the foundational cornerstone of that. Peace, it says, is a state of tranquility or quiet, the end of hostilities. There's a lot of people that are at war with themselves. The disciples in this passage were at war with fear. They were at war with all the things that they wanted to do. They had a vision of who they would be, and they couldn't be that vision anymore. Peter had said to Jesus, I would die for you. Now he's up in a room with the doors locked. I talk about Jesus' teleportation just kind of as a joke and the supernatural element of it. But let's go to verse 19, because Jesus, I put unlocked fear. He doesn't just unlock fear. He doesn't really care about unlocking fear. He stands in the midst of it. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for what? Fear of the Jews. Maybe you have a fear as well. Jesus came and did what? Stood among them. I can say two things. One, Jesus didn't knock. I love it. Didn't knock. And he didn't ask to have the door unlocked. He came and he just stood in the fear. Man, that is so powerful. They weren't even looking for him to do that. He just showed up at the right time and he was there. This week, I had a moment when I was meditating on this scripture. And when I think about my own fears, my own anxieties, all the things I've dealt with in my life, usually my mind goes into mental calisthenics of how I'm going to fix it, how I'm going to do something that is going to make everything okay. And so I lay in bed at night and I scheme and I plan and I wait for that thing to get that peace of mind that comes when knowing you're behind on your bills or something and you go and then an unexpected check shows up. What happens? You have the peace. All the peace is based on what is happening on the outside. Jesus just comes in and stands in the midst of it. And so I stood there this week realizing if I had fear, if I had anything in my life, I'm just going to meditate on Jesus coming and just standing there in the midst of it. But he doesn't just come and stand there. He comes and offers something. He comes and he says, peace to you. The other thing that I also like in this passage is Jesus offered peace, but he didn't vanquish the reason for the fear. He didn't show up and say, hey, by the way, I took care of, you know, the Jews, especially that real giant one and that Roman centurion, I took care of them. Like, I came back on the horse. I took care of all the things that are plaguing. No, he didn't fix it. What he actually fixed was on the cross. Because what he was bringing is the foundational cornerstone of peace that you can have no matter where you are. You can have that peace. And so that he was offering them something beyond the circumstances. Now, if he would have come in and said to them, I fixed all your problems, then they would have had peace. But what would the peace possibly have been based upon? All of your problems being fixed. Now, Jesus fixes some problems. I gotta say, he's really good at fixing some problems, and he works at that. But he's not about fixing problems, except your main core problem we have, which is often ourselves. And he brings peace in the midst of it and doesn't always change your circumstances. There's a verse in Philippians. When my mom accepted Christ, she wrote this verse by hand and put it up on a wall, and it was at my grandma's house forever, back in the 80s. And it says, there's a part in the scripture that it says, be anxious for nothing, but in all things through prayer and supplication, giving things to God. It says, make your requests known unto God, and he will give you what? A peace. But it says that that peace transcends understanding. I don't want a peace that transcends understanding. I want a peace of my understanding. I want to know that the bills are right. I want to know that that person's not upset with me. I want to know that my wife and I, about an argument, it's been settled, or if there was one, or if with my kid, or. Jesus says, what the Bible says is, I don't care about all the circumstances. Yes, I care. I love you, and I want to help you sort those things out. I don't want you to live in suffering and pain all the time. But what he says is, I want to give you a peace that transcends all understanding. And so when he shows up, he doesn't change the outside circumstances. I say, can you have peace without the outside circumstances being changed? Jesus says you can. Why? Because the peace he's given you is peace from the heart of God himself, that he scoops it up and it says that it is here. What is interesting is if you look at it, it says when after he said this, he showed them the treaty, that's my word, of his hands and his side. It says, and then what? The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Systematically, it works this way. Peace is the foundation of joy. Peace is the foundation of joy. I think we are living in a society that says, find the next excitement, and then you will have joy. You will have peace. You will have these things. But we're not building it on that foundation. Turn it over, the next thing, as we come and circle the tower for a landing on this sermon. The next thing is we see that Jesus comes and he brings a peace offering. If you know what a treaty is, right now they're working on a treaty right now. If you're following the headlines of what's going on in Ukraine, if you were to study, war, oftentimes there is a white flag, and then one battling army will come out to another and say, hey, we're going to give you a little bit of land, we'll give you some money, we'll pay tribute, we'll start paying taxes. This happened in England a lot. We will give some type of treaty, and we will sign a treaty. If you study World War II history, it was a Treaty of Versailles in World War I that was actually broken by the Germans, but it was a treaty that they said put too much onerous things upon Germany, and hence you had World War II and the breaking off of that. When Jesus comes and brings a treaty, he doesn't bring a map to you. He doesn't bring you something that he shows you that he's going to offer this and that. What Jesus shows here is his hands and his feet. Why is that a treaty? Because someone, as I said earlier, has to pay for sin. We understand in our secular society today that it's interesting that the word sin is being used again. You're starting to see people who don't follow or are part of a religious in any way, they start using a term. So you'll hear that, that for right now, racism is the, according to many, the original sin of our country or whatever. You're seeing this word sin. It is interesting that we have some agreement now, at least in this, that there is sin in the world. God is perfect, and no amount of sin, none, can be with a perfect God. That's the whole reason that Jesus died on the cross. And there had to be justice, because God cannot allow sin not to be paid for, because otherwise he wouldn't be just, right? And so he pays it himself in this. I would say that it's interesting, because then he comes and he shows this peace treaty to them. He says, here's the treaty. I have made peace. With whom? He says, I'm making peace with you. He doesn't say, I'm making peace with you. He says, peace be to you. He gives them peace, but he doesn't bring the treaty to them and say, hey, let's have a peace treaty. He says he has already made the treaty. And you know who he took the treaty to? He took it to his father, because that is who was offended by sin. And what he did was he showed them the peace treaty. But he said it, the peace was not made between them. It did give them peace because he brought peace to them. The peace that needed to be made was peace with God, and he made it. Three quick things, we're done. Of all the possible first statements Jesus could have said to the disciples after rising from the dead, he chose to say peace. Have you ever thought about that? Like, if you raise from the dead, pretty cool, supernatural, by the way, and you show up, and you show up in the room, you teleport into the room through the wormhole, and which is so cool. I think it's super cool, but it's super sci-fi. And Jesus shows up. What's the first thing you're going to do? Are you going to go like this? Like, woo, check me out, you know? Or perhaps like, dude, I told you I'd be back. You know, you do something, right? Or like, let's go do this, you know? Or let's go get the Romans. You would say something. Like, what would you say? You're raised from the dead and you show up. Let's go, you know, whatever. You know what he says? It's really interesting. This is the first thing he says. The first thing that comes out of his mouth. Actually, he spoke to women first, which is really cool. He meets women. The first people he showed himself to was women. I think that's so cool. Met him in a garden. He just like chatted with a bunch of women. The fact that he met Mary in the garden was super cool. That goes back to the Genesis passage. The Bible is so intricate and powerful and amazing. But he shows up, and the first thing he says is peace. He says, I'm going to bring you peace. I have made peace. I have taken sin upon the cross, all sin, and I have paid for it, and now there's peace. I made a peace treaty. I want you to know you get to be the beneficiary of it. The first thing he said was peace. So many of us need peace. We live in a world that needs peace. The other thing that's interesting, he says, Jesus did not say peace be to the world. He said, peace be with you. He said, peace be with you. He's offering peace. Now, you can choose to take it or not. That's the thing about Jesus. He never forces anybody to do anything. He's like, I have peace. I have made peace. I've restored it. Now, peace be to you. The Bible, following Jesus, is a personal, individual faith. Granted, it's community. One of the things we wanted to highlight today was when we were thinking about the Easter sermon service, we're like, you know, should we blow it out and like amaze everybody with an incredible service? And then they come back next week, we're back to normal again. I said, let's just do our normal service and let's highlight our people. Let's highlight Jesus. We'll do a great sermon. We did, you know, an extra song. We do the flower cross. They've been doing that for 700 years here. I don't know how long we've been doing it. But other than that, we just want to show our people because Jesus is dwelling in our people. And I don't know if you noticed it, but like, I hope you got welcomed on the way in. Like, we want this to be this incredible place where you experience that in the individuals. And so what Jesus offers, he offers it to individuals. And I will say that one of the things we sell short in church sometimes is how much God loves you personally. Like, it's not sinners in the hand of an angry God. Jesus doesn't want you to stop all the things you're doing because he just made up a bunch of arbitrary rules. He knows what's best for the creation. And any rule he gives that would be called sin is made for a reason because it's best for you, because he loves you. It says in Romans, the reason he gives all the rules, the reason it exists, is because God loves you. To not tell you what the rules were wouldn't be loving. It's like my 2-year-old daughter, if she was walking around with a fork, a knife one time, and there was an electrical socket, and she was like almost like licking it, getting ready to shove it in the electrical socket. I'm like, you know what? I don't want to mess her mojo up. You know, you do you. You do you. No. But tell her, don't put the fork or knife into the electrical socket, because I love you. And that's what God's doing. He's not just here to be a buzzkill, but he offers peace to you, and maybe you need peace. And then the final thing, the nail-scarred hands and feet of Jesus were displayed as a proof of the peace, a treaty with God. And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and his disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. In the final movie by Clint Eastwood, not his final movie, but he made a movie in 1992 that won Best Picture. And it basically was another Western that ended Westerns for 20 years. There was a few made, but hardly any Westerns were made after this movie. Why? Because it took 70 years of movie making about, you know, rootin' tootin', shoot 'em up, justice, and it brought it back to a human element of an outlaw who was dealing with his past. And in the movie, Unforgiven, Clint Eastwood plays William Money. And the Schofield kid, if you remember, is this young kid, stupid kid, who thinks he's all that, and he's nearsighted, he's never shot at anybody, he's acting like he's tough, and he rides in to find William Money. He goes, "I hear you're William Money," and he says, "Yes, I'm William Money." He says, "I'm going on a killing," and he says, "I'm done with those, I don't do that anymore," says Clint Eastwood. And he says, "Well, this guy, he cut up a woman." And then he says, "Oh, really?" And he says, "Yeah, he cut up a woman, there needs to be justice." He goes, "Well, I don't like that," and he goes, "I need the money, so it seems like a righteous killing, I'll do one more," and he rides with the Schofield kid. Well, on the way there, Schofield kid ends up killing another man, but he doesn't kill him in a gunfight and anything with glory. He actually walks up to him, if you remember, and he's in an outhouse and kills the guy in the outhouse. And now he's dealing with his shame because he's got no peace. Check it out.
It don't seem real. I ain't gonna never breathe again, ever. How he's dead. And the other one, too. All on account of pulling a trigger.
It's a hell of a thing, killing a man. You take away all he's got, and all he's ever gonna have.
Yeah. Well, I guess they had it coming.
Other times, sorry, I was off my mic. Other times, there's people that, they just kind of hang out and check things out for a while. If you want to know more about Jesus, we have a couple things you can do today. One, if you need to be prayed for today, you're like, "I need prayer," you're just a believer and you want to pray for someone in sickness or whatever, we have an amazing prayer team. If you just want to be prayed for today, come forward for prayer after the service. The other thing is, if you want to know more about how to get involved and how to find out more about our church and more about Jesus or just check things out, there's a Next Steps table out there. We have an amazing brochure. Just pick up a brochure, go home and check it out. Come be a part of an incredible family. One